Okay, we all stand together and let's worship the Lord one more time before Steve comes up. Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing. But am I alive? I won't keep searching for answers that aren't here to find. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not I belong. In this world again, Jesus. I have this blessed assurance holding me. All I know is I'm not home yet. This is not I belong. In this world, give me Jesus.
That song just totally resonates with me. I love that song. I so know I don't belong here. I'm just passing through. You all feel the same way? Don't run off afterwards. Let's reacquaint. Oh, I can't wait. And all God's people said, amen. Yeah. Oh. Cool. Do it. I get confused with the technology, but I'm learning. All right, so if you recall, last time we were in the book of Revelation, and we were looking at the judgment scroll. So we saw, John saw in heaven this scroll with seven seals on it. And I told you seven stands for the number of ultimate completeness and all that sort of thing. Something else I learned when I was in Israel this last trip, I saw this ancient Roman document with seven seals. If you became a citizen of Rome, your citizenship paper had seven seals. And each seal represented a witness to your citizenship. And as I mentioned before, messing with that thing was a life sentence, and forging it was a life sentence. So nobody messed with those things. But they took citizenship. You know, when you have a country full of slaves, it really matters if you're a citizen or not. So I just found that this seven seal thing was pretty cool. Seven witnesses. And it's interesting that after Jesus breaks open each of the seven seals, we go into the seven trumpets, which are won by different angels. And so the last seal of judgment busts open the seven trumpets. But before we got to those seven trumpets, which we're going to look at today, I taught you through the seals. And the first four were the four horsemen of the apocalypse, the guys we're seeing here. And they represented famine, war, and all sorts of charming things that death comes by. And then the seven trumpet judgment. So we got seven seals, seven trumpets, and then in the coming weeks, seven bowls. The thing is, when we got to the seventh seal, it looked like the world was destroyed. It couldn't get any worse. And that's just the first set of sevens out of 21. And I thought, holy cow, these are going to be some dark days. Could it get any worse? Oh, yeah, baby, we're just starting. It's that bad. You're going to see. Let's take a look. We're in Revelation chapter 8. I'm going to be in verse 2. We're talking about these seven trumpets that these angels blow to pour out their wrath on earth. And I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. Verse 6. So the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound. Trumpet number 1, verse 7. The first angel sounded, and hail and fire followed, mingled with blood, and they were thrown to the earth. You might think, hail, that's not such a big judgment, Steve. Well, we get hail here every summer, and it's kind of fun. We like to look at it. But it doesn't cause serious damage. It's not like it breaks car windshields on a regular basis or ruins houses. I know there's some hail in the Bible that talks about hailstones that are going to weigh like 100 pounds each. You get hit by one stone, you die. What happens if 400 of them hit your house? Now, I don't know if this is the 100-pound hail or not, but it doesn't need to be because this hail is mingled with fire. How do you like that? I can't even imagine it. Some people, they don't. They just say, oh, it's lightning. No, I don't think so. I think it's fire because the plague in Egypt was hail and fire, and the word there in the Hebrew was fire. It wasn't lightning. There was a separate word for lightning. They didn't use that word. They used the word fire. So this is a divine thing, fire and ice coming from the sky. Not a good time. So hail and fire, and it says mingled with blood, and then a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. A third of the trees. How many of you remember the big fire up north just a couple years ago, up in the White Mountains in that area? What was that, like 500,000 acres or something crazy like that? It was horrible. But I've been up there. There's still a lot of trees left. And that was just one small forest in a country full of forests, in a country full of worlds with forests. It was nothing. It was a blip. All the trees will be destroyed. Can you imagine? I can't imagine a world without trees. It's going to be horrible. And they have some nice benefits for the planet. You know, erosion. They inhibit erosion. They produce oxygen. They're homes to birds and bugs. And it's not going to be a pretty time. All the trees are burned up, or a third of them, and all the grass. So a third of the trees and all the grass. It said, hail and fire mixed with blood. So is blood raining down from heaven? Or is it the consequence of the hail making the blood because it's hitting people and animals and killing them? Either way, it's not pleasant. I don't know which it is. I imagine it could go either way. It's kind of gross. So some of the plagues that God's pouring out on humanity are like natural in appearance, like the four horsemen. They represented war, violence, famine, and death by beasts. Well, we've had war. We're having war right now. And we don't see anything divine about it. We've had famine. We've had death by beasts. We've had violence. So some of God's plagues don't appear supernatural. But some of them, I think, do. Like if this fire and hail thing is literal. We've never seen that before. Nobody's ever seen fire and hail come together before. That's just crazy. How does fire come from the sky? That's extreme. And then with the blood mingled in. So the idea is some of these may look naturalistic in origin, some of them may not. And it makes me think, well, what naturalistic in origin type of things could this be? Like maybe biological warfare? Maybe some of these things are like us doing this to ourselves? When I lived in Southern California, we had this thing called acid rain. You've ever heard of that? Imagine it's raining outside and your car gets muddy from the rain. That's just gross. That is gross. And they say, wash it off your car or it's going to etch your paint. Acid rain. Well, if we saw that back in the 80s, what could happen with the mad skills we have now? Or maybe it's a toxic spill on a global scale. Do you remember when Saddam Hussein was being defeated? He set on fire all the oil wells he owned. Just made a global nightmare. Some people are just, they're nuts. They'll do crazy and stupid things. You know, it bothers me. I think it's very unwise, all these oil rigs out in the ocean. I think it's stupid. When Japan built a nuclear power plant in a tsunami earthquake-ridden zone, didn't anybody think that might not have been a good idea? Afterwards, they realized it was a bad idea. But is that stopping people from still doing it? It's not. When an oil rig breaks, it just pours tens of thousands of gallons of oil into the ocean, and we've got rigs all over the place. One earthquake, a bad group of terrorists, nah, no bueno. I think what we're seeing in Revelation chapter 8 is the entire planet is going to look like a wasteland. It's not going to be pretty. These will be very dark days. Jesus said this about those days. This will be the worst time of suffering since the beginning of the world. Nothing this terrible will ever happen again. And if God doesn't make the time shorter, no one would be left alive. But because of God's chosen ones, He will make the time shorter. This is the end of humanity unless God steps in. This is what it's saying. We will be totally destroyed, but God will step in. But He's not going to step in before at least a third of all the trees are destroyed and all the green grass is burnt up and the world looks like a wasteland. Something else about this passage of scripture I just read to you. The worst time of suffering since the beginning of the world, and nothing this terrible will ever happen again. There's this teaching called preterism. Preterism teaches that the book of Revelation is all history, that it's all symbolic of the horrible things that happened to Israel during the Roman occupation and the Roman War. None of it's our future. It all happened. And I'd like to say, you know, only five people believe in that doctrine, so we don't have to worry about it. But a big portion of the church believes in that doctrine. This is a verse that makes that doctrine impossible. Jesus said, I quote again, the worst time of suffering since the beginning of the world, and nothing this terrible will ever happen again. Well, since the Roman world, has anything terrible happened again that bad? The Roman War against the Jews was nothing compared to World War I and World War II. Nothing. That was much worse. And they didn't see total devastation of the planet or even of the Mediterranean back in these days. So there is nothing that could even apply. No, it has to still be our future, which is, at least we know we're right, but boy, it's not something to be excited about. That's only the first trumpet. Next trumpet. Then the second angel sounded, and something like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea became blood, and a third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. My guess? A meteorite. And that's why I got this animation for you. I think something that looks like a burning mountain that's thrown into the sea. What else could it be but a meteorite? Am I certain? No, I don't know. That's my best guess. I do know that as a result, a third of all the creatures die. So I'm going to call that from the impact. And it says the sea. Well, there are several seas. Which sea? Well, this is Israel focused, so this must be the Mediterranean Sea. So I'm thinking in our future, a meteorite, is going to hit the Mediterranean Sea and wipe out one-third of all the sea life in the sea, destroy one-third of all the ships in the sea. And then it says a third of the sea becomes blood. All right. The way I look at things, there's three options. How does a third of the Mediterranean Sea become blood? Well, it can be a miracle that God literally turns it into blood like he did the Nile River in the days of Moses. That's one possibility. The other possibility, this meteorite just says it's going to kill a third of the creatures in the sea. Maybe it's their blood. So that's also a possibility in my mind. And it could just be a euphemism. A third of the sea turns blood for massive death. A third of the sea is death. Could be a euphemism. I lean towards numbers 1 and 2. I don't think it's the euphemism, but it could be. I really don't know which one it is. Second trumpet judgment. Now we move on to the third. Then the third angel sounded, and a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch. And it fell on a third of the rivers and on the springs of water. And the name of the star is Wormwood. A third of the waters became wormwood, and many died from the water because it was made bitter. This star that falls to earth destroys one-third of the fresh water, makes it poison. Now, how do you do that? The Mediterranean, I can see it. It's one body of water. But how do you destroy a third of fresh water? It's everywhere. How does one star do that? How does one physical event destroy one-third of the fresh water? I don't understand. I have some thoughts, and I'll share them with you. First of all, I don't think it's a star. I don't think it's a meteor. I think it's an angel. But Steve, it says it's a star. Yes? Yes, it does. Let me give you three reasons why I think this star is an angel. First one is the language that's used. A great star fell. Why is it called a great star? Because just a second ago, we saw a burning mountain. And I said the burning mountain, I think, is a meteorite, because I don't know what else it could possibly be. So assuming that's correct, this wouldn't be the exact same thing. Two plagues back to back, the exact same thing, but using different words. I suppose it could be, but that doesn't work for me. So my first reason thinking it's not a meteorite and it is an angel is because it just doesn't work with the language. Secondly, angels are called stars in the scripture. So this is not me reaching for something. This is a known thing. For example, in Revelation chapter 12, verse 4, speaking of Satan and his war in heaven, it says, his tail drew a third of the stars of heaven and threw them to the earth. Almost all Bible commentators, everyone I've seen, says this is the war in heaven and the rebellion against God, and a third of the angels rebelled and went with Satan, and Michael threw them out, and they're called stars. Fallen stars, because they're fallen angels. So here we see a great star falling from heaven. Ah, I think this is a fallen angel. In fact, in Revelation chapter 9, one of the stars is unmistakably a fallen angel. That's a he. Revelation 9 says, the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fallen from heaven to the earth. To him, here we go with a person now, to him was given the key to the bottomless pit, and he opened the bottomless pit. And smoke arose out of the pit like the smoke of a great furnace, so that the sun and the air were darkened because of the smoke of the pit. The star falls, and he opens up the pit. It's a fallen angel, as far as I'm concerned. And it's only a few chapters after the chapter we're in right now. Third reason I think it's a fallen angel and not a meteorite, it says that this mountain that fell with the other trumpet, that it killed a third of the sea life. Wormwood is going to kill a third of the fresh water. What was the mountain called? No name. But this falling star is given a name. Nowhere in the Bible are meteorites named, but stars are, and angels are. Well, it can't be a star because we know stars are suns. So all I'm left with is a fallen angel. And it says he turns a third of the water poison. Now, with a meteorite, I can see a plain physical impact doing that. But how do you ruin a third of the waters with a physical impact? All the fresh water. I can't see it as being a physical phenomenon. I could see an angel making that happen, a demon making that happen. I could be wrong. I don't know. I'm just giving you my reasoning on it. And can things get any worse? Yes, indeedy. Verse 12. Then the fourth angel sounded, and a third of the sun was struck, a third of the moon, and a third of the stars, so that a third of them were darkened, and a third of the day did not shine, and likewise a third of the night. How many of you watched the news a couple days ago about the solar eclipse? Any hands? You know about it at least? You heard about it? Europe has gone solar in power production. I don't remember if it's 30% or something like that, or 40% of their power is solar now. So they knew they were going to have a total solar eclipse. And that meant no sun for what, 2 or 3 hours. And they thought, what's going to happen to our solar supply? Our grid's going to crash. This is going to be a big test. We don't know what's going to happen, but we think it's going to crash. And so the sun goes dark. They do all their backup power supplies, and everything seems to be working all right until the sun wakes up again. And then it floods them with too much power, and their system burped. But they covered. They recovered. It worked out okay. They did get a surge, though. Well, if Europe is just now starting to experiment with solar power, and they think 3 hours of little bit of sun on one day might ruin their system, what's going to happen when they're 50, 60, 70% solar powered and the sun turns off every day for a third of the day? We're going more solar powered. And what else are we going? We're going wind powered. We saw angels in the last chapter shutting down the wind. So we're looking at the physical impacts on the earth, but think of the economic and the impacts just on life in general. If we've not already been destroyed from the four horsemen of the apocalypse, I mean, this is just going to be bad times, people. That's why the scripture says there's never been anything as bad as this, and there never will be. Bad days ahead. The earth is falling apart during these days. Let me read to you a passage from Isaiah. A supplemental note I gave myself here. It says this in Isaiah 24. The earth reels like a drunkard. It sways like a hut in the wind. So heavy upon it is the guilt of its rebellion that it falls, never to rise again. And that day, the Lord will punish the powers of the heavens above and the kings on the earth below. They will be herded together like prisoners bound in a dungeon. They will be shut up in prison and be punished after many days. The moon will be abashed, the sun ashamed. For the Lord Almighty will reign on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before its elders gloriously. The earth is falling apart. It staggers to and fro like a drunkard. The heavens are falling to earth, and even the heavens themselves are falling apart. It's going to be scary. How many of you have ever been through an earthquake? Can I see hands? Was it scary?
Yes.
Yeah, it's scary. Your whole world shakes. It is scary. I've never been through a big one, but I've been through lots of little ones. I used to live in Southern California. And it's like, I can't do it because I have my computer here. Well, let me show you kind of what it's like. You're just sitting there minding your own business, and all of a sudden, it's like, dang. And it's not just the podium. It's the ground. It's the ceiling. It's the walls. It's the windows. And sometimes it goes like this. Did you feel that? Those are the small ones. They just get you scared. The big ones, everything starts flying and you start heading for the door hoping things don't hit you on the head on the way out and that your house doesn't fall down. If you're on the road, you see the road doing this. Can you imagine how freaky that is? That ain't nothing compared to what's coming. That's just a taste. Men's hearts will be failing them for fear. In fact, things are so bad that the angels can't even believe it. And I looked, and I heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth because of the remaining blasts of the trumpet of the three angels who are still to sound." These angels are going like, guys, wow, wow. We're not even done yet. I mean, if you're amazing angels, you know things are really bad. And this is how chapter 8 closes, with the angels just going, whoa, whoa, whoa. Could things possibly get worse? Yeah, we got a few more trumpets to go, and then the bowls. Why would God do this? That's a kind of question people will often ask. In fact, a friend yesterday told me that one of his acquaintances had stopped going to church because he was seeing all the bad things in the world, and he just couldn't understand how God would allow such things to happen. So it challenged his faith in God. And that is probably the number one challenge to faith, is the bad things that happen in the world. People will come up and say, yeah, I don't believe in God because a whole bunch of bad things happen in the world. And I would say, well, what makes you think God's responsible for that? I say, well, God's all-powerful, isn't he? Well, wait a minute. You just quoted the Bible and saying God's all-powerful, and then you're using the Bible to say you don't believe the Bible. You can't do that. If you think there's a real God and he's sovereign, you can't also get upset with him for his choices. He's sovereign. He knows what he's doing. If he's not there, I saw another article that said a bunch of atheists are angry with God. And I thought, wait a minute. And it's true. I've met many this way. They will swear there is no God. They don't believe in him, but they're really mad at him. It doesn't make sense. The thing is, they do believe in God. They just can't admit it to themselves, but they don't want to believe in God because it doesn't jive with what they want to experience and believe. And I'll be the first to admit, I don't appreciate suffering in the world either. And I'm often talking to God and say, God, but my mind knows it's not God doing it. Here's what I mean by that. Why would God allow this to happen? Let me give you a few answers. First answer, much of what we've read, God isn't doing. We're doing it to ourselves. The four horsemen of the apocalypse, everybody's heard of, right? War, violence, famine, and death by beasts. Who's responsible for war? God makes us go to war with one another? God is forcing ISIS to go through the Middle East and kill people? Of course not. Every war, World War I, World War II, Vietnam, Korea, Genghis Khan, God didn't do that. We do that. Well, bad things happen. Yes, they do, but we do it. God doesn't. Well, what about famine? Consequence of the war. People, you know, when I was little, my mom said, finish your dinner. There's kids starving in Africa. I'm like, so send it to them. There are people starving, but it has nothing to do with God. We've sent so much food to Africa, it's amazing. The warlords steal it. And why don't they have food in Africa? Africa is an extremely rich nation. I mean, they've got natural resources to have great life. Why don't they? War. Bad guys doing bad things, taking advantage of good people, ruining life for everybody. Most of the suffering we experience, even here, up until at least these natural catastrophes, are man-made. And some of these natural catastrophes may also be man-made. We don't know yet. I'm not saying God's not involved. Don't hear me saying that. God's very involved. But let's point the finger where the finger belongs. On us. We're the ones doing this. So, first answer is much of this we're doing to ourselves. Second answer is God's judgment is justice. It's not like God is rounding up all the nice people on the planet and doing the best he can to make them miserable. That's not what's going on at all. God has been reaching out to people for thousands of years through Moses, through David, through Paul, through Jesus. He sent his son to die for people's sins. What are people doing with that? Most of the world is disrespecting it, even mocking it. In fact, killing the representatives of Jesus throughout the Middle East right now. And it's nothing new. It's not just ISIS. Christians have been martyred ever since there's been Christians, and before them it was the Jews. And now it's the Jews and the Christians. The voices of God are being silenced by murder. God's getting those people. In fact, he oftentimes, the judgments will parallel the crime. Let me read to you a passage of scripture from Revelation chapter 16. For they have shed the blood of the saints and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink, for it is their just due. So, a third of the Mediterranean becomes blood. Desalinization plant, how does it take blood out? I know it can take salt out. So it's kind of like, hey, You have shed the blood of the prophets. God's given you blood to drink. That kind of mentality. So we look at the judgment on the earth and we think, oh, it's not fair. No, it is fair. It's just. God has given humanity thousands of years to walk with him. And if my theology is right, he's going to take all of his people out of here before this happens anyway. And if he doesn't, my second theology will kick in. He'll take care of us anyway. That is, from the plagues that he descends upon the planet, not from martyrdom. He doesn't protect most of his people from martyrdom. See, Steve, that's kind of jacked up. Well, yes, in one respect it truly is. But in another respect, what's going to happen after you die as a martyr? You're going to be with Jesus in heaven. That's good. I'm like, dude, whack off my head. Make it fast, make it quick. I'm going to see Jesus. Ah, but before I go, let me urge you to reconsider. Because this knife that you're about to put on my throat is going to send me to heaven, it's going to send you to hell. Is it really worth it? You're mistaken. Let's have a conversation. You never know. I don't know. So, three reasons. Much of this we're doing to ourselves. Second, God's judgment is justice. And thirdly, to get people to repent. Whatever it takes for God to give his children a chance to turn from their wickedness, he'll do it. God doesn't want any of us lost. He'll do whatever is necessary to save as many of us as possible. For some people, it's the carrot. And for other people, it's the stick. And the carrot means God has expressed his love and has offered salvation to whoever wants it and has given us a book that if we will follow it, we will have peace on earth. It's not working for everybody, though. So next comes the stick. And he turns up the temperature and says, pretty uncomfortable, isn't it? Can we have a conversation? Nope. Turns it up a little more. Now can we talk? Do I have your attention yet? I've shaken up the planet. I've destroyed a third of the trees, all the burned up all the grass. You ready to talk to me yet? Nope. Turn it up a little more. He's done all the love, and now he's going to do all the discipline. And two things will result. The bad guys will be destroyed, and they deserve it. But the unsure will have a chance to repent and get saved, and they will. So it's going to totally separate the wheat from the chaff in that respect. And then the end comes. Me, I'd like to think I'm a carrot guy and not a stick guy. I don't know. I think we're all a little carrot and all a little stick. But these things don't concern me. This isn't for me. This is for the people later in the future. Now, how far in the future? I don't know. It could be next week it starts. I don't know. This really could be just right around the corner. The rapture happens beforehand. So hopefully somebody will grab this message. Or one like it. If it doesn't happen, we're going to have a lot of talking to do and a lot of people listening, I'm thinking, because they're going to be shook up. Here's what I'd like to do with you right now. I'm done. But I want to take a moment to pray. And I want to pray for the people who are going to experience this stuff. Do you believe that our prayers now can impact the generation of the future? I do. It's the God of the future we're praying to. So I believe we can pray for people who are not yet born and maybe help them out. So I'm going to ask the band to come on up. And while the band is doing that, we'll pray. Lord God, I want to thank you for giving us a heads up and letting us know what's coming. And I pray that you would give us the ability to share faith with people now so that they could avoid these dark, dark days. But we together, we want to pray for this generation of people who are going to be living through this nightmare, this terror, this judgment, and this justice. Because some of them will repent. That's why you're turning up the heat. Lord, so we pray for those people that you would grab their hearts earlier the better, that they would see that you are real and that you had offered love and they had spurned your love and they had practiced evil, even have killed your people, and that you're still reaching out to them, offering them an opportunity to repent. Even Jesus himself on the cross said about his murderers, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And so I know, Lord God, that you forgive murderers. You forgive the wicked. You forgive the guilty. And so we pray for them. And then lastly, Lord, but definitely not least, I pray for my brothers and sisters who are listening to me right now. Some of them have not yet made a commitment to follow you. Their hearts are still not soft. They're thinking about it, but they haven't made the commitment. I pray you'd draw them, open their ears, open their eyes, open their hearts, that they might become your children and experience the joy of heaven now as we wait for the return of Jesus. For it's in his name we pray. Amen.
So small, standing here weeping as I'm coming clean. Secrets I'm keeping cause so much pain to the ones I love more, and I'm falling apart as I carry my heart to your throne. I am completely surrendering, finally giving you everything. You're my Redeemer, I run to the cross because you are more than enough. Lord, complete. You pulled up my selfishness from it through. I am a broken and fragile me, but I'm where you want me to be. I am completely surrendering, finally giving you everything. Never failing, let mercy fall. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of the Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures.
A blessed week, a glorious week. I look forward to seeing you on Wednesday night. Don't forget about our Easter outreach. Today's the deadline for sending folks our snail mails. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and grant you His peace. God bless you hard. You are dismissed.
Make a way for Make a way for, make a way for the King. The King is coming. Feeling up.
coming undone. Every eye is looking out for you.